presence of my enemies. And I raise a hallelujah louder than the unbelief.
Morning. Good morning. If you would please join me in our call to worship. Responsive reading number 61. Stand up and bless the Lord your God forever and ever. Blessed be your glorious name, which is exalted above all blessing and praise. You alone are the Lord. You made heaven and the heaven of heavens with all their hosts, the earth and everything on it, the seas and all that is in them, and you preserve them all. The host of heaven worships you.
Blessed be the glorious name, which is exalted with all blessing and praise.
We have the slides. If you'd pull the first one up, that the Voice of the Martyr sent us these slides to guide our prayer time this morning. They've invited us all in churches to join this global prayer movement, an International Day of Prayer for Persecuted Christians. And there's just a few slides here, but I want to follow their format. And this year is specifically about the Word of God getting to people. And getting scriptures in people's hands in these places where folks are being persecuted. So next slide, please. It says the Christians living on the world's most dangerous frontier mission fields cherish God's word. And then we're asked, next slide, to pray that every Christian living in hostile areas and restricted nations will receive their own copy of the Bible. Would you take a moment where you sit and let's pray that folks would receive a Bible in those hostile areas. Let's pray together. Lord, wherever the Word of God is most needed today, even in those dangerous places, we ask, oh God, that you would provide. That somehow, some way, that your Word would get in people's hands. whether it be through missionaries or whether it be for those who find some way to, as a Christian, to smuggle them in or however it might be, Lord, would you provide the word to the people who need it the most? Lord, would you give them access? And we thank you for the voice of the martyrs and others who are working to get the word of God in people's hands. And we pray this day that people would not only have your word, but they'd read your word, they'd hear your word, they would understand it, and they would apply it to their living. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Next slide. Persecutors around the world are threatened by God's word and seek to destroy or remove Bibles in order to discourage the witness of Christians. And then we're going to have two prayer slides. Let's do the first one. Pray that Christians will be wise as serpents and innocent as doves as they smuggle and distribute Bibles. So let's pray now for those who are distributing Bibles, who are smuggling Bibles into places where it's very dangerous. Let's pray. Lord, we pray even now for those who are actively seeking to bring Bibles into countries where it is against the law even to have a Bible. But they're getting them in. They're getting them to people so that they might read your word. And so we pray, oh God, that you would give those Christians wisdom to again be very wise in how they do that. To be wise in how they get the Bibles to people, for those people's safety and for their safety. But most of all, wise so that your word would go out to this generation of people around the globe. We ask in Jesus' name. And then next slide, we're asked to pray that the persecutors, when they seize those Bibles, would read them and that they would begin to trust in Christ as they read those Bibles. Let's pray together. Lord, we pray for those would-be persecutors that when they seize Bibles, that they wouldn't just seize them and throw them away, but they would come alive in their hands. And your Holy Spirit would draw them to reading them, to opening them. Lord, that even though they're fearful of the Word and they have a hatred for the Word, that you would just bring them under such conviction that they can't help but be curious and read. And in reading, that they would come to your saving grace. That they too would become followers of the Lord Jesus Christ. In your name we pray. Amen. And then next, placing a Bible in the hands of every believer living on the world's most dangerous and difficult frontier mission fields. Pray that it will encourage them to be bold witnesses for Christ. And we're asked specifically to pray that they may hasten the fulfillment of God's promise that the earth be filled with the knowledge of the glory of the Lord. Let's pray together. Lord, we do pray that the earth would be filled with the knowledge of your glory. That around this globe, people would come to saving faith in you. And that you would receive all the praise and the glory and the honor. That you would be exalted. Lord, we thank you for these brothers and sisters who at such risk go out and share the gospel. Watch over them, protect them, use them to bring glory to your holy name. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. And then there's a final prayer for us that the Voice of the Martyrs asks us to pray together. So if you would you join together with me as we pray this prayer? Heavenly Father, inspire us through the example of our persecuted brothers and sisters to cherish your word. May we serve you boldly so that others may be filled with the knowledge of your glory. Amen. To God be the glory. Thanks.
Please stand and sing 10,000 Reasons. Will the children come forward for children's time? All right. Good morning. I'm going to start you off with a pop quiz. What season are we in right now?
Fall.
Very good. What is the prettiest thing about fall? Absolutely, you are so smart. Okay. So, what makes the leaves turn color?
The color
Okay. What color is chlorophyll? Green. Yes. So the leaves are... What happens to them? Yep. Right. And so what's left in the leaves? The other colors, yeah, of other chemicals, very good, very good. But guess what? Those colors of those other chemicals have no real purpose except to be beautiful for us. That's why God did that. That's why he made those other chemicals different colors to be beautiful just for us. Because you know what the Bible says? The Bible says that if we're smart, we can look at nature and know that there's a God. That's what the Bible says. It says we can look and see all these cool things that God made and know there's God. But God didn't just leave it at that. He didn't want us to just know there is a God. He wanted us to know him. So he wrote this big book here. Now, some people say, well, God didn't write that maybe. Well, guess what? God did write it. He used 40 people over 1,500 years, but we know that he wrote it. Because when you get bigger, I hope I'll be around when you do, and we'll do a whole class on all the ways God hides little things in here that makes sure we know he was in charge of writing this book. The people didn't do it. Well, they did it, but they did it with the Holy Spirit telling them what to write. Isn't that the coolest thing? Because now, if we want to know God, know him better, know who he is, know what he thinks, know what he wants us to do, we got this whole big book we can check it out in. So as y'all get bigger, you're going to learn all kinds of really, really neat things out of the Bible. It's very cool. Why don't we pray and thank him for that? Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for giving us the book so we can know you, and for sending Jesus so we can know you even better. Amen. Thanks, guys.
Please stand and sing with us our praise medley, Offering and Rock of Ages.
Shadow in your presence.
Amen. Please be seated.
Amen. Thank you. Amen. Love the music. I get caught up in the worship and just want to keep worshiping at that point. So thank y'all so much for leading us in worship. And love the children's time. It just brings joys to our hearts, doesn't it? But I was listening to Terry talking with the kids, and I'm thinking, they're getting too smart for me. Wow, the stuff that the kids know. Wow. But what a joy. What a joy. Let's pray together. Lord, just much on my heart and mind about your church today and the blessing of being in your church. And I pray that others feel that. What a joy to be here together in the house of the Lord and to worship you. Lord, I don't know what everybody's week's been like. Perhaps they've been long. Perhaps they've been difficult. Perhaps it's been a great and easy week. I don't know, but it's good to have these moments together, to come into the house of the Lord and to worship together, to sing your praises, to enjoy our children and the blessings that they bring to our lives, and to enjoy each other and to hear the voices of one another and just to exalt your name. So thank you for that. We also thank you for the chance to gather around your word. As Terry shared, you gave us your word, that over thousands of years you wrote your word through various authors. But it's your word. It's your words for our life. And so, Lord, we pray that you would just inspire again today the reading, the hearing, the understanding and the application of your holy word. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. We're continuing in John chapter 4. Bucky and I have actually been teasing. I hope Bucky's listening today because he's preaching for me later in November. And we've been talking about how long it's taken me to move through John. And he says, so you may still be in John chapter 4 when I preach at the end of November. But hopefully we won't still be there. And Bucky's actually preaching on the 20th, by the way, on the theme of Thanksgiving. Because the next weekend we'll enter into the season of Advent. It's hard to believe it's already here. But we're just continuing to work through John. We'll take a little break at Advent and work on an Advent theme, and I'll share more about that later. And then we'll jump back in to John's gospel in the new year. Remember last week in John chapter 4, we looked at Jesus' encounter with the Samaritan woman and all that had meant. And remember, the disciples had been away through most of that encounter, and now they're back. So John chapter 4, verse 31 begins, "Meanwhile, the disciples were urging him, saying, 'Rabbi, eat.' But he said to them, 'I have food to eat that you do not know about.' So the disciples said to one another, 'Has anyone brought him something to eat?' Jesus said to them, 'My food is to do the will of him who sent me and to accomplish his work. Do you not say there are 4 months, then comes the harvest? Look, I tell you, lift up your eyes and see that the fields are white for harvest. Already the one who reaps is receiving wages and gathering fruit for eternal life, so that sower and reaper may rejoice together. For here the saying holds, one sows and another reaps. I sent you to reap that for which you did not labor. Others have labored, and you have entered into their labor.'" Thanks be to God for his holy word. Amen. Well, it seems a woman was trying to get the ketchup out of the bottle, and you know how difficult that can be sometimes. Nowadays we have squeeze containers, but back in the day they were all glass, right? And during her struggle, the phone rang, so she asked her 5-year-old Amanda to answer the phone. And when Amanda answered the phone, she very obediently and gently said, "Hello, this is Amanda." But then she said, "Mommy can't come to the phone. She's hitting the bottle." Such misunderstandings like that can cause all kinds of disturbances, and they can be difficult to correct. I'm sure the mom stammered just a bit as she came to the phone. Today we're continuing to work our way through John, and what's going on here is the disciples, much like the Samaritan woman, they just don't get it. They don't understand what's going on, and as I said last week, we probably wouldn't either. We saw last week that while Jesus was having a conversation with this woman, the disciples were in town and they were buying food. In our text today, they've come back in verse 31. They're concerned that Jesus needed to eat. They say, "Rabbi, eat." But Jesus replies, verse 32, "I have food to eat that you do not know about." Well, of course the disciples don't understand. And so in verse 33, they begin to say, in effect, "Did you give him something to eat?" No, well, who did? Maybe the Samaritan woman gave him something to eat, or maybe one of the townspeople. Who fed him? At this point, can you just see Jesus shaking his head and saying, fellas, slow down. You don't understand. My food is to do the will of him who sent me and to accomplish his work. And I think in the conversation of this conversation with the Samaritan woman, Jesus is saying that he found great nourishment in talking with this woman. He found great nourishment in seeking to save a lost soul. For him, that was far greater a blessing than any food could ever provide. And I think he reminds you and I in this text that our greatest blessings, and the greatest blessing, is our relationship with God the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Sure, we need a certain amount of food. Sure, we need clothing. Sure, we need shelter. We need a certain amount of possessions to survive. But the real joy in our lives should be and can be when we know we're living within the will of God. Jesus lived to do God's will. That was the essence of his life. And doing God's will gave Jesus great satisfaction. Compare, for just a moment, I want us to compare Christ's obedience and the satisfaction he got to Satan's disobedience. Isaiah 14 tells us of Satan's disobedience, beginning with verse 12. "How you are fallen from heaven, O day star, son of dawn." And that's Satan. "How you are cut down to the ground, you who laid the nations low. You said in your heart, 'I will ascend to heaven above the stars of God. I will set my throne on high. I will sit on the mount of assembly in the far reaches of the north.'" Next slide. "I will ascend above the heights of the clouds. I will make myself like the Most High. But you are brought down to Sheol, the place of the dead, the underworld, to the far reaches of the pit." There are at least two things we see about Satan's disobedience in this text. First, he tried to rise above the station God had given him. He tried to go outside God's will for his life. He tried to ascend to heaven above the stars of God. He went so far as to try to make himself like the Most High. And secondly, he strongly asserted his will. Count the use of the pronoun "I" in these few verses, and you'll find that Satan used the word "I" 5 times in 2 verses. "I will, I will, I will, I will, I will." How different that is from Jesus, who said, My food is to do the will of him who sent me and to accomplish His work. Jesus fully submitted His life to God's will for His life. What about us? Are we willing to submit to God's will? James warns in chapter 4, verses 13 to 15, "Come now, you who say today or tomorrow we'll go into such and such a town and we'll spend a year there and trade and we'll make a profit. Yet you do not know what tomorrow will bring. What is your life? For you are a mist that appears for a little time and then it vanishes. Instead, you ought to say, 'If the Lord wills, we will live, and we will do this and do that.'" It's about submitting to the Lord's will, folks. It's about finding pleasure and joy in submitting to His will. James Boyce writes that he's afraid we're something like the little girl of some time past who wrote her grandmother to thank her for her Christmas present. She wrote, "Dear Grandma, thank you for the pincushion. I have always wanted a pincushion, but not very much." Perhaps we're like that. We say to God, "God, I'd like to know your will. I've always wanted to know your will, but not very much. At least not the way you outline it in Scripture. I'm not sure I really want to surrender that much." You see, the point is that we're not only to know God's will, we're to surrender and do God's will. Jesus didn't say, "My food is to know the will of God." He said in verse 34, "My food is to do the will of Him who sent me." Jesus didn't just give God lip service, and neither should we. You remember the parable Jesus told the Pharisees and the scribes about the two sons in Matthew 21, beginning with verse 28? He asked, "What do you think? A man had two sons, and he went to the first and said, 'Son, go and work in the vineyard today.' And he answered, 'I will not.' But afterward, he changed his mind, and he went. And he went to the other son, and he said the same, and he answered, 'I go, sir.' But he did not go. Which of the two did the will of his father?" And they said, "The first." You see, it's clear that we must do God's will. We must act. Now, some of you are going to say, I know what you're thinking. You're going to say, "Well, you know, Danny, that's fine. I would do God's will if I just knew what God's will was." Well, I know what you mean. And I know you're asking, "Well, what's God's specific calling for me?" But here's what I've learned as I've discerned my calling through the years. Take the next faithful step. Take the next faithful step. Start by doing what you already know to do from God's Word. Start doing what you already know. Read the parable of the talents when you get home today. It's in Matthew 25. And you'll see that Jesus was very clear. When we're faithful in little things, He'll give us bigger things to do. We got to start doing what we already know to do. And what do we already know to do? Well, in our text today, in verses 35 and following, He's talking about the harvest. He's talking about sowing. He's talking about reaping a harvest. He's talking, folks, about evangelism. He's talking about sharing the gospel. We already know to do that. It's not just the calling of one who calls himself or herself an evangelist. It's all of our calling to share the gospel. There are hundreds of clear-cut biblical statements telling you and I what we ought to do. Matthew 5:16, "Let your light shine before others so they may see your good works and give glory to your Father who is in heaven. Be a witness, be an example, let the light of Christ shine." Matthew 5:44, "Love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you. John 13, 34, a new commandment I give you, to love one another. Just as I have loved you, you also should love one another. Romans 12, 1 and 2, present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. That's your spiritual worship. Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewal of your mind. I could list many more, but I think that's enough for today. Here's the thing. God's clearly revealed His will for us. It's right here. It's already written down for us. The problem, I'm afraid, is that we're a little bit like that little girl. We don't very much want to do God's will. We're hesitant to do what He's already showed us to do. And finally, I think we need to see that Jesus didn't just say, my food is to know the will of Him who sent me. And He didn't just merely say, my food is to do the will of Him who sent me. No, He said, verse 34 again, my food is to do the will of Him who sent me and to accomplish His work. Jesus accomplished what He came to accomplish. That's why upon the cross, one of the very last things He said was, it is finished. I've accomplished what I came to accomplish. Nearly 40 years ago now, a little pamphlet, a little booklet titled Many Aspire, Few Attain, touched my heart and my life and continues to speak to me. Unfortunately, it's out of print. But if you Google it when you get home, Many Aspire, Few Attain, you can find a PDF file on it and read it for yourself. I still have my original copy, and I pull it out every now and then, and I take a look at it. And that booklet is a sermon Walt Hendrickson preached when he was with the Navigators Ministry, which started out in the Navy and then spread onto college campuses around the globe. And it's a reminder that many of us begin well in our Christian walk, but precious few of us end well. Many aspire, few attain. Many begin well, precious few end well. Many of us are like the seed in Jesus' parable, which fell on the shallow, rocky soil. We start out really well, we spring up, but then our roots are so shallow that we don't end very well. We don't persevere. But Hendrickson wrote in that pamphlet that there's some things that you and I can do to finish well. And I want to just share just a few of those this morning. There's actually a dozen or so in the pamphlet. But one of the ways that you and I can finish well is with a heart focused on God. That our hearts are focused on God. King David wrote in Psalm 27, 4, one thing I ask of the Lord, this is what I seek, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord forever, to gaze upon the beauty of the Lord and to seek Him in His temple. You see, David didn't say, I'm going to dabble in these 40 things. He said, no, one thing I seek, one thing I ask for. I want to dwell in the house of the Lord. I want to finish well. I want my heart focused on the Lord. The Apostle Paul said something similar in Philippians 3, verse 8. He said, indeed, I count everything as loss because of the surpassing worth of knowing Christ Jesus, my Lord. For His sake, I've suffered the loss of all things. I count them as rubbish. He actually says, I count them as manure, in order that I may gain Christ. And then verse 11, that by any means possible, I may attain the resurrection from the dead. You see, David and Paul had their hearts focused on God. That they had an end goal, a dwelling in the house of the Lord forever. They were determined that they were going to finish well, and they were going to accomplish God's will for their lives. And so I want to ask this, are you determined? Are you focused? Are you resolute at this moment that I'm going to finish well? I'm going to run the race. I'm going to keep my focus on the living God, and I'm not giving up. And then a person who wants to finish well is going to have a hunger for God's Word. They're going to spend time in God's Word. They're going to meditate on God's Word. They're going to apply God's Word because you know what? They know that that's the very place they're going to find the will of God written down. God's already revealed what we're supposed to do in His Word. So we need to understand it. We need to understand what He's saying if we're going to do it, if we're going to accomplish it. So do you have a hunger for Scripture? And then a person who accomplishes God's will, who finishes well, is also going to hate sin. Romans 12, 9 tells us, abhor what is evil, hold fast to what is good. The word abhor actually means to throw up. It means to vomit. It means to hate sin so much that it makes you sick on your stomach. The person who finishes well is going to hate the sin in his or her life, and they're going to seek to repent. They're going to seek to change. So, beloved, do we hate sin? Are we seeking to repent? And then I've already mentioned this next one, but a person who's going to finish well, he or she's going to be faithful in the little things. When there's something to be done for the Lord, no matter how small it is, they're going to do it. You can count on it. You can check it off of your list. It's going to be accomplished because they're going to be faithful in the little things. And they're not going to worry who sees them. They're not going to worry about who gets the credit for it. All they're going to worry about is whether or not, have I been faithful? Have I done what the Lord asked me to do? Are you faithful in the little things? And then a person who finishes well is not only going to do the little things, they're going to do them wholeheartedly. They're going to do them without complaining, without thinking, why do I always get stuck doing this? 2 Chronicles 25 says of King Amaziah, verse 2, he did what was right in the eyes of the Lord, yet not with a whole heart. Yet not with a whole heart. Apparently he did what was right, but his attitude wasn't very good. He was not wholehearted in his devotion to God. Are you and I wholehearted? When we're given a task, no matter how menial it might be, that people can say, they're wholehearted. They know it's for the service of the Lord, and they're going to go after it. I can't always say that. Today's a day for all of us to examine our hearts. Are we wholehearted? Are we doing it out of just a sense of what an honor it is to serve the Lord? I've joked many times that I should have been keeping a list all these years of the things I do as a pastor that were not taught in seminary. But sometimes those are the ministry. Those are the very things that the Lord wants us to do, and He wants us to do them wholeheartedly. And one more thought for today. Those who finish well, those who accomplish what the Lord gave them to do, they avoid an independent spirit. They avoid an independent spirit. They're not mavericks. They're not loners. Some people see they claim they want to serve. But here's the deal. They want to serve only if they can serve their way and their way only. We see this independent spirit sometimes among people who think they don't need the church. They claim to love Jesus, but not His church. Look, I know the church is far from perfect. I know that leaders like me are far from perfect. But I've never seen anyone finish well in the Christian walk if they didn't love the Lord's church. Never. will one finish well if they don't love the Lord's church? This is the institution God established for accomplishing His will. And we're just not going to finish well if we look at the Lord and we say, I love you, Lord, but I don't like your bride. I don't love your church. Are you avoiding that kind of independent spirit? Jesus said, verse 34, my food is to do the will of Him who sent me and to accomplish His work. Is that our food? Is it our pleasure and joy to do God's will and to accomplish God's will? Is it our joy and our pleasure to do what God has taught us to do in His Word? Is it our heart's desire to run our race and finish it well? Let's pray together. Lord, help us to finish well. There really is no retirement in the Christian walk. Oh, we may step down from a particular calling or some, there may be something we've always done that we recognize that maybe we're a little too old to do, but we never completely retire. And so, Lord, I pray that no matter what our age today, that we're heart-focused, that we're focused on You and we're committed to finishing well. Lord, I pray that whatever our age, that this very day we're saying, I'm going to have a hunger and a love for the Word of God. And Lord, whoever we are and whatever our calling is, I pray that we're going to commit to You in these moments, that we're going to be faithful in the little things. We're going to do them wholeheartedly. We're going to do them without grumbling. And Lord, even as we pray that prayer, somebody's going to call on us today to clean the toilet or to do the dishes or to sweep the floor or something we don't want to do. I pray that we do it as if serving for You with all our heart. And then, Lord, I would pray that we'd avoid that independent spirit. That we'd realize all the more as we see the day approaching, as we're told in Hebrews 10, as we see that day approaching, that we'd gather together and that we'd work together to accomplish Your will. That we'd recognize that we might be living in the end days. And if we're not at the end of the days, as we know creation, we could be living in the end of our days. So help us to run our race, to do it well, to gather together to accomplish Your will. We ask all this in Your beloved Son's holy name. Amen.
Stand and sing, Purify My Heart. Purify my heart, let me be as gold. Thank you.
Now may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. And may the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you his peace today and forevermore. Amen.